Today we're playing with Tim Holtz and Ranger's new distressed paint. They're water-based, and like all distressed products, they have some unique properties that we'll explore and learn to take advantage of. The initial release is 24 colors from the full palette of 48. We'll mix, mist, and otherwise get messy with them, having fun all the while. Let's talk about what makes these paints uniquely distressed, and that of course is going to be their water reactive qualities. Now whether you work with them directly out of the bottle, if you take the top off and you use a brush or your fingers, they're always going to be distressed and they're always going to react with water. Now these paints are very fluid and there's a mixing ball inside each of the jars that you need to get in the habit of using to shake the product and make certain that everything is distributed. So you can hear that mixing ball moving around in there. They all have a dabber top, and to start them you have to press down. Obviously this one has already been used, but you press down, you'll hear the little click as the valve opens, and then it's just a question of putting it down on the surface and squeezing. And you can put it on with the dabber top, which of course will leave some streaks, and that always lends some really interesting texture. You can brush it out, or you can even use your fingers if you want. The paint is really easy to work with. Now going back to what makes it uniquely distressed, you can see how nice and smooth this surface is, but the minute I introduce water, it's going to react, and it's going to react quite differently than most paints will because it's distressed. And you can see that you get that bubbling that goes on, and you can see where the paint has now changed a little bit because of the water. And of course, depending on how much water you add, and let me just put some more on here, you can see that we'll get a lot of different things going on. This will run and it will drip, and you get that really cool texture effect that is so uniquely distressed. Now what makes these paints very different than the other distressed products is twofold. The first is that they're opaque, which means when you put them down you're going to get coverage, and that means that you'll get coverage even on something like a black tag. So if I come in here, now obviously it might take two coats, but I'm going to get some really good coverage over that black. So the opacity is very different than all of the other distressed products, which tend to be translucent. In addition to that, these paints are permanent once they're dry. They're permanent on paper, they're permanent on fabric, they're permanent on metal, glass, and a variety of other surfaces once they're dry. At times today you'll see me hurrying the drying along with a heat gun, but that has nothing to do with making them permanent and just everything to do with getting them to dry in a rush so I can move on to the next thing. So that is a huge advantage. Think of all the things that you can do on fabric, whether you're working on an art quilt or you want to stencil a design on a tote bag or anything like that. Now you don't have to worry about heat setting, it's just going to be permanent, and there's going to be only a slight change in the hand of the fabric. There's going to be some, but it's going to be very minimal. This is just the beginning, and next we're going to take a look at using the distress wrinkle-free technique, which you've seen me demo before, but we're going to do it with the paints and we're going to work on the nonstick craft sheet. You've seen me demo the distress wrinkle-free technique in the past, but let me show you how cool it is using these paints. First thing I'm going to do is give them all a shake to make sure that the paint is well distributed in the bottle. And then I've got a tag I'm going to start with. I'm going to use three colors, and I'm going to just put some of the color out on the craft sheet. Now these colors are pretty dark, and those of you who watch the videos with any frequency know that I really do prefer lighter colors, so I'm going to put some white on the craft sheet too. Colors are ready. I'm going to come in and I'm going to put some water on there, and you can already see what happens. Obviously with these being distressed, I've already got some movement going on. Take my tag and I'm just going to swipe it through, and look how cool this is. You get this fabulous marbling that happens. I don't know what it is about the distress paint that does this, but it's just stunning. Now I really like this, so I'm not going to come in and add any water. I'm going to take this to one side and dry it and let it dry in this effect, and I'm actually going to hit it with the heat gun now so that I don't lose that. This tag is dry now, and because I took the time to dry it while it still looked like this, I captured all of the dribbling, all of the marbling that was going on in here. If I'd wanted to change that, I could have spritzed some water on it and let the paint react with the water and then dried it to capture that marbling and that cool striations that happen. But I liked the way that it looked, so I didn't feel the need to do that. Now, the really unique thing about this paint, along with the fact that it's permanent when it's dry and it's opaque, unlike the other Distress products that are more translucent, is that I can feel almost nothing on here. I've used the colors on a journal page, and what I discovered is that the Jelly Roll pens work like magic on them, and I'm going to guess that most of the markers and pens that I use will work the same way. So it's a very matte, very solid feeling surface, almost chalky, but it doesn't rub off on your fingers. Well, this is dirty fingers. It doesn't move or anything, of course, now because it's permanent. So this is just wonderful. Now you can see that I have some left here, and of course I can use this technique on many things, not just on a tag. I have these really cool little teeny gift bags, they're called, and I started to play with these the other day and realized how much fun they are. I'm going to come in and just give a little bit more of a spritz to the paint that's left on my craft sheet. Now it's already started to mix, so I'm probably not going to see color exactly the same way on this bag as I will here, because I've already got some mixing going on, but that doesn't mean that I can't use the paint that's, oh, how cool is that? I can't use the paint that's on the craft sheet to pick this up and add color to this little bag. Now we're going to take a look at these bags a little bit later on to see what they do, or what rather what you can do with them, but how incredibly cool is this? Now the one thing that you do have to be cautious of is that you take a peek every now and then as you're turning this over and putting it in the paint, because you don't want to lose and make mud when you get colors perhaps on the opposite side of the color wheel that start to mix together. So tags, bags, our craft envelopes from Meyer Road, they're going to work just as well. Let me just start and see what this looks like as I kind of squish it through here. There's not a lot of paint left, but you got to kind of get the idea. And of course, if I want to add some more, I can. These bottles dispense, they don't draw in, so I can put some more on the craft sheet, and I might get a little bit on that dabber, but it's really easy to wipe it off. It's not like I'm going to pull paint inside of the bottle and start changing the color. All right, let's stop knocking things over left, right, and center here and play with this. And again, this is just so incredibly cool. But of course, once I get the flap of this done, and of course it's all curly now because the paper's fairly thin, but you can see what's going on here. I get this flap done. That means that I can decorate the front of the envelope if I want. Now, I don't worry too much about the back because I'm going to attach that to a journal page, but what I'll get is this really cool front flap that contrasts very strongly with the plain front of the craft envelope. After playing with the paints and that wrinkle-free technique that I demoed just a moment ago, I got to thinking that I'd really like to use that as a background on one of my journal pages or on a full spread, as you see here. Now, that's great if you're working in a small journal, say something 5x8, but on this big format dilutions journal, and I love working this size, the thought of picking this up, turning it over, smushing it on the craft sheet, just got to be a little bit too much, and I tried to figure out a better way. And then I might have happened across a piece of a non-stick craft sheet that I might have cut by accident with a rotary cutter, forgetting to put the cutting mat down. That's the allegation. I'm not admitting to anything, quite frankly. But here's a small piece that I cut off of that one. What I'm going to do is I'm going to put the color down on here, I'm going to wet it, and then I'm going to turn it over and smush it on the page, which will get me virtually the exact same technique, but it means that I'm not holding the weight of this journal with the pages flopping around, trying to smush it around on my craft sheet. So again, I'm going to give my paints a shake. I have a fairly large area that I need to cover, so I want to be certain that I get enough paint out here. And if you're interested, the colors that I'm using are picked raspberry, spun sugar, mustard seed, and I'm going to come in with some more white because, again, I want to lighten those colors a little bit, and this kind of helps extend those colors. All right, that's probably enough to do maybe one half of this. So, again, I'm going to come in, I'm going to give this a nice coat of water, and it's already starting to do its distress magic. So what I'm going to do, let me slide this so you can see. I'm going to turn this over, and I'm going to smush it on the page. And holy cow, that's fantastic. What I'm going to do is pick it up rather than keep dragging it around, because every time I drag it, I destroy the previous pattern. And obviously, I really like that, and I don't want that to happen. So I can get a lot of different things going on here, but this incredibly cool marbling that happens just absolutely fascinates me. And the nice thing about working with a smaller piece of the craft sheet, oops, see, I just made a mess of that. There, that's better. The nice thing about working with a small piece of the craft sheet versus an entire, I think they're 15 by 18, is that, you, as you noticed as I was smooshing this around, in an area where there was no paint, the craft sheet was falling into an area where I had already put the paint down, and that tends to disturb the pattern. So if you really like the pattern, then obviously you want to be careful not to do that. So maybe it's not such a bad thing that I might have forgotten what I was doing and cut the craft sheet with a rotary cutter. Again, I'm not admitting to anything, I'm just saying it might have happened. What I'm going to do is, I'm probably not even going to miss this. I like this patterning so much. So what I'm going to do is dry this side, and then I'm going to repeat that process so the whole spread is done this way. But by drying this, again, because it's permanent once it's dry, I can put a gallon of water over this page if I want, and it's never going to affect the paint. So then I'll have this entire page spread done that I can come in and stamp and journal over, collage elements on. There's just all kinds of things that I can do. And again, I cannot emphasize enough, the surface that's left when this paint dries is so smooth and so matte that you can just do virtually anything over the top of it. If you prefer your backgrounds a bit more subtle than the one I created in the last segment, you can certainly do that with distressed paint too. What I'm going to do is take, this is brushed broken china, I'm going to put that across this entire page spread, and then we're going to do a couple of things. I'm going to add some circles with a different color, and then I'm going to dribble water on it to really take advantage of that distressed property. So I'm going to begin by shaking this up, but rather than apply it to this large area with the applicator top, I'm actually going to take the top off. Now I do have to be careful that I don't pour out the mixing ball, but I can get quite a lot of paint on here without having to mess around with that dabber. Put this over to one side so I don't knock it over, and then I'm just going to brush. Now I have some clean water nearby, and what I'm probably going to do is put my brush in there. Even though this is very fluid paint, getting it across this large expanse of area is helped by adding a little bit of water. It stretches the paint, you don't have to use quite so much, and it actually makes the whole process quite a bit easier. Now obviously you don't want to get too much water on there. You want just enough to sort of thin that paint out a little bit and really get it moving. All right, I think I'm going to have to come back and drop a little bit more paint over here. I'm going to put some there. I'm going to put a little bit here. Want to smooth the brush strokes out so they're kind of all going in the same direction, and then I'll come and finish this side. Now this is broken china, and what I'm going to do for a little bit of contrast, I have, what do I have over here? I have bundled sage. I'm going to put some of it on my craft sheet. I'm not going to put it directly on the page, and then I'm going to use these dabber thingies. Of course, at the moment I can't think of the name of them, but they'll be on the website so that you can see what they are, and I'll give you a link to them. Let me put this out of the way. Give this a shake. And I'm just going to squish some of this out. I know you can't see it, but I'm going to squish some out on my craft sheet, and then I'm going to pick up the spouncer. This is what they're called. They're made by Plaid. I'm going to dip the spouncer in the paint, and then I'm just going to dab it in places on the page. Now this has got some pattern and some texture, but it's far more subtle than that page spread that I did a moment ago. And I'm going to put some more paint out here. The spouncers are available in a couple of different sizes, so I'm going to grab the smaller one, and I'm going to apply that in some places as well. Now I don't want to wait too long because the paint is already starting to dry in places on the background, and I won't get as much distress reaction if I wait too much longer. So I am going to just finish up here with a small spouncer. I'm going to come in with my mister, and I'm going to start dribbling water on the page. And you can see the reaction happen the moment the water touches the wet paint. Now up here, it's a little bit dry, so I'm not going to get the reaction, but that's okay. This provides me with an interesting page background without quite as much crazy movement as in that other background that we did a moment ago. And I like them both, quite honestly. It really depends on what you want to do. Some days I want crazy, some days I want a little bit more subtle, and this is certainly a way to achieve that. I want to finish today by talking about the unique quality of the distress paint that sets it apart from everything else in the distress line, and that's the fact that this is permanent once it dries. Now you can see the patterning, that cool marbling effect that happened on this is that little white bag that we looked at earlier. This is another one that I used, and what I did was I put some modeling paste through one of our stencils, and I'm going to show you that in a second. But the real important thing to note here is that once I put the modeling paste on, unlike when you've seen me do this in the past, and this was done on a piece of chipboard that I gessoed, that I sprayed a very little amount of dilutions or color wash on, and then I added the modeling paste over the top of the dried spray. Once I came back and started to use the iridescent medium to coat this entire piece, all of those sprays begin to lift a little bit, and you can get some really cool effects by using your brush and creating patterns with the brush strokes. But having said that, if you'd prefer not to have any movement, then the way to go is to use something like the distress paint, because it's not going to move. So for example, this is our flower patch stencil, and what I'm going to do, actually before I start, I'm going to fold this little top flap back because I don't want to get any of the modeling paste on there. Not only am I going to fold it back, but I'm also going to take a piece, this is just drafting tape, I'm going to take it and make kind of a loop with it, put it on the back, and that's going to hold this in place so that it doesn't move when I apply the light modeling paste through the stencil. Alright, so with that done, I'm just kind of picking an interesting section on this stencil that I like the way that it looks. I'm allowing the flowers to run off. I think that provides a real nice organic look. This is Liquitex light modeling paste, and I'm just going to carefully apply it through the stencil to get the pattern of this group of flowers. Now you can do one of two things. You can kind of put this on loosely the way that I am here so that you have some areas that are peaked and some that are smoother, or you can scrape right across here like this with your palette knife and smooth that all down. I like the kind of organic irregular look you get when you just sort of let this flow, so that's what I'm going to do. I am going to take some of this excess off. That might be just a bit too much. There's no point in wasting the modeling paste. Alright, and so then I'll lift this up and you can see that I have this really cool texture on here. Now obviously there's some on the craft sheet around that, and I need to pick this up carefully and move that away, but the most important thing to note is that unlike this that I showed you a moment ago, where the minute the modeling paste hits the color that's on the gesso, even the modeling paste will begin to change color, that's not going to happen. You can see how white this remains. There's no hint of the yellow, the pink, or the orange that happens to be on this envelope. It's all in place and it's not going to move. I'll let this dry and then I'll do the same thing I did here, which is to use the iridescent medium from Liquitex, and I'll just brush it over the entire envelope. Once that's done, this is something new that I just have started to play with, are these really little bags. The cool thing is that a number 5 tag fits perfectly inside. I can put this on a journal page if I want. It can be part of a mixed media collage. It would be cute as on the inside of a card where you could tuck something inside, whether it was a tag like this. The ATCs will fit in here. It's just a smidge tighter fit, but it certainly will work. If I could actually get this in there. And there's less of it that protrudes out of the top. You could use it as a money holder on the card. These little bags are wonderful. They're available in white and craft, and you can do lots of great things with them. The distress paints are new. I think that they are wonderful to work with. I like that super matte finish that I get when I put them on a page. It means that I can use my pens and my markers and get really cool effects and not have any difficulty writing on those pages. I hope you use the distress paints to make art and have fun.